Hello and welcome. One of my favourite comedic actors was British star and member of the Goons, Peter Sellers, whose films like the Pink Panther series, Dr. Strangelove, The Party and Lolita entertained millions around the world. In 1979, his film Being There, a brilliant political satire co-starring Shirley Maclaine, was in competition at the Cannes Film Festival. But there was great speculation in the London media that illness would prevent him attending the festival. You see, some years prior to that, he had once clinically died. So the speculation about his health was quite serious. But Peter did attend the festival, and a few days after the film screening, he sat down for a series of one-on-one interviews at the six-star Hotel Du Cap along the coast from Cannes. Little did I know it would be one of his last English-language TV interviews. I began by asking him how he came to get the role of the enigmatic character Chauncey Gardner, which won him an Oscar nomination and a Golden Globe for Best Actor.
Peter, your performance in Being There is superb. You were interested in the film, in the character particularly, for a very long time. Can you tell us a little bit about how you came to get it?
Yes, in 1972, a friend of mine gave me the novel to read, and I was so taken with the novel, and of course the character, that I took it to my friend Hal Ashby, who at that time just made a couple of films, Harold and Maud and The Last Detail, and neither of us had a backlog of things where we could really get a film set up, but we tried, and we couldn't get anything going, so each year we'd have another bang with somebody else, you know, but then Jersey didn't want to sell it at one stage, you know. So we kept plugging away, and then suddenly Hal phoned me, when I was doing one of the Panthers down here at Caffera, and he said, do you know, I think we've actually got it this time. And I couldn't really believe it. But it was Providence, because it wouldn't have been a good thing to make it in 72. It's a film for the 80s, really.
It is, very much so. What can you describe the character, Chauncey Gardner? I mean, what's he like?
Well, that's one of the most difficult things to do. Because, I mean, I can only describe the obvious things about him. You see, it's very necessary to see the film to understand the fact that, let's take the basics. He's a person who's lived in a conditioned environment since he was a child. He may have been an illegitimate child of the old man. He may have been an orphan. Anyway, he was never allowed upstairs. He was never allowed around, only to the attic to wear his clothes. And he was first bred on the radio and then television. And he lived his whole life, sort of very sedentary life, in that garden. Sometimes the old man would come and sit in the garden, but that's all. And old Louise, she was like a mother figure, and the old man, when he saw him, was like some strange father figure. So when he was turned out by the attorneys, he was turned out into, I can imagine where that house was situated. In the days when he was a kid, must have been a really swish neighborhood, instead of a ghetto, which it is now.
The character itself took some considerable work on your part to get it just right, and you told me that there came a point right near the start of filming where you felt that you couldn't play it. Is that right?
Yes, I felt, you know, right in the very beginning that we got the film on the road, we were all set to go, the money was there, a company were putting the money up to make it, and Hal had scouted out around North Carolina for Biltmore, the Vanderbilt house there, which we used, and I suddenly thought, oh my God, I don't know how to play Chance the Gardener.
How did you get the voice and everything to sublimate yourself so much?
Well, of course, it's a process of tape recordings you do, little tests, to keep the credibility in the character. First of all, I bled it of everything, just made it a straightforward English monotone sound from no particular area. If you remember in the book, it says when they computerized his voice, they couldn't designate that it had come from any. So I had to do that first. So he had to speak without any particular sound, and from any part of the world. He had just a straight sort of voice. And then I fed in some American sounds into that, some words, such as, in a way you would say chance. He would say chance, but it wouldn't be chance, you know, hard one like that, because he couldn't talk like that anyway. Had to be more of a, you know, very quiet, hello, Vladimir, you know, and stuff like that.
Mr. Gardner, my editors and I have been wondering if you would consider writing a book for us, something about your political philosophy. What do you say?
I can't write.
Of course not. Who can nowadays? Listen, I have trouble writing a postcard to my children. Look, we can give you a six-figure advance. I'll provide you with the very best ghostwriter, proofreaders.
I can't read.
Of course you can't. No one has the time. We glance at things. We watch television.
I like to watch TV.
Oh, sure you do. No one reads.
How satisfied were you with the result when you saw it up on the screen?
Well, I love the film, of course. Absolutely love the film, but I never really satisfied, you know. I never really get to the stage where I can say I'm satisfied with it.
Peter, you've been working very hard recently, and you've been a little bit ill. How are you now, and what sort of work pressures have you got?
Well, I'm not pushing myself with work at all at the moment, apart from what we're doing today. I'm fine now. I'm fine.
You, and with the heart attack a little while ago, you...
No, that actually wasn't a heart attack.
No, but...
in the beginning?
In the
64. Oh, yeah, that was a bad one.
Have you considered death and facing death and going through that process?
Yes, I certainly have. As I say, the sort of death that comes from that is like just going to sleep. Because I was, at one stage, when they were trying to get my heart going again, clinically dead for nearly... the ultimate time before we become vegetable, 3 minutes almost. And if that's what it is, then I can just sort of maybe just say, listen, everybody, you got nothing to worry about. Obviously, a violent death is very difficult.
So you've resolved the situation, at least in your own mind.
Yes, I don't know what is beyond that, unless one, you know, believes. Like I've studied various religions, including Hinduism and... And I've studied yoga for a long time, and I've been looking around there and trying to see what everyone has thought over the years about what there is. And these people who, like Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, swore that he would come back and tell us all about, and Lord Trenchard and all.
You're still waiting for him, aren't you?
Well, I think everyone's waiting for him, you know, apart from the clairvoyants.
Yeah. And what about Lynn? Is she going to do some work now, or is she going to be working with you?
She'd be working with me. She's going to... She's always preferred... She never liked acting. Although she was a good actress and is a good actress. Preferred always to... And she's very good at, like her mother, the administrative side. So she'll be associate producer on... and really she's great at that because she takes all the nerds off your shoulder, you know.
So what will be the next film that we'll see you in?
Well, you may see me in a film before the film I make called The Fiendish Plot of Dr. Fu Manchu, in which I play two roles. Yes, which is, it's just another film, let's put it that way.
And you're going to do another Panther film?
Yeah, that's the next one I'm going to make, yes, in November.
Okay, Peter Sellers, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very sadly, barely 2 months after we did the interview, Peter collapsed and died in the Dorchester Hotel in London on the eve of a planned Goon Show gang reunion. His final film was indeed The Fiendish Plot of Dr. Fu Manchu, co-starring Helen Mirren, American comedian Sid Caesar, and John Le Mesurier.